grains to be offered to the Lord on this day.
那这个礼拜也是很机巧的跟父亲说，就在我们家附近有两个人呢、啊，这个 Jagna 跟 Hiranya， 他们两个人在家里有煮了谷物，正要供奉给主。
So please take me there.
所以你带我去他们那儿。
So Jagannath Mishra was wondering how he could have known that.
这个爸爸就是 Jagannath Mishra 就想这小孩怎么知道人家在做什么。
So he took him to the home of these two Brahmins.
所以这父亲就把这自己的孩子带到这个婆罗这两个婆罗门家里去。
And he found out that actually these two Brahmins had in fact cooked this offering, including grains to be offered to the Lord.
所以到他们的家里真的看到了，这两个婆罗门真的是有在煮这个谷物，而且是要在做供奉。
So he understood all of this. Nimai could understand because he was a supreme lord.
所以这个时候，这个父亲就了解到呢，这个尼麦是一个很特别的，而且是至尊主。
Another pastime when he was very young is he kind of took pleasure in splashing water on the orthodox Brahmins.
啊，还有另外一个小时光，就是这个尼麦喜欢呢，在婆罗门家里的神坛去洒水。
To kind of show that just to be a Brahmin in name only and not be a Vaishnava is not very valuable.
所以呢，他要展示的就是说，如果只是一个婆罗门的一个称呼头衔，如果不是一个 Vaishnava 的话，他这个是一个婆罗门是没有什么意义，没有价值。
Now is Nimai is.Becoming around 5.
这时候尼麦到五岁这个时候了。
And from 5 to 10, he was very much engaged in academics, you could say.
所以五岁到十岁，就是我们说上学那段时光。
And very quickly, whatever he was taught, he retained and he was able to repeat verbatim.
就像说，我们一般人说比过目不忘这种能力还强，所有他看过听过都记得。
And he then very quickly became known as Pandit, great scholar.
所以他在学习的路程里面，很快就是变成很有名的一个 Pandit， 就是一个很有名的学者。
Also, in this period, his father departs from this world.
在那段时光呢，他父亲离开这个世界。
The Lord also gets married to Lakshmi Devi.
那主也由于母亲的安排娶了一个女孩，这个Lakshmi Devi.
And at age 11, he begins to debate with scholars and defeat them one after another.
当他十一岁的时候，他已经可以有这种能力。就是说辩论这个学者都有一种经常性的辩论可以驳倒其他人的这个论说。
One of the first persons he comes in contact with is someone by the name of Tapan Mishra.
他曾经接触的第一个人这个学者叫 Tapan Mishra。
Tapan Mishra. Tapan Mishra was quite a learned scholar.
Tapan Mishra 是一个很有名很有学问的学者。
But the Lord wanted to teach him that it's not just by reading many books that one becomes truly educated.
那这个时候主也要给这个人教训，不是你读了很多书就是真正你是一个学者，或是你真正懂了。
And the Lord easily defeated him, although he had so much knowledge.
那主非常容易的就他才这么年轻就把这个人的这些论点都驳倒了。
And he was bewildered how this could have happened.
所以呢，这个学者就很迷惑，就想这怎么可能呢
？So that evening he had a dream.
这人呢，这个学者晚上做了个梦了。
And he was then told clearly that he should take shelter of Lord Chaitanya's lotus feet.
那在梦里面有一个很清楚的讯示，就是说他应该去接受主 Chaitanya 的庇护。
Learning that he was indeed Krishna.
那当然可以了解到梦里告诉他的这个人就是 Krishna。
But probably the most famous scholar that Lord Chaitanya defeated was a personnel named Keshava Kashmiri.
那在那么多跟学者辩论的过程，最有名的一个叫Kashmir。
Keshava Kashmiri。
Keshava Kashmira 这个学者是最有名的一个。
Kashmiri。
Kashmiri。
So this Keshava Kashmiri, he was such an accomplished scholar.
Keshava Kashmiri 呢，他是一个就是说学问非常高的一个学者，跟他是可以平等的对手。
He was known as the Mahapandit. He was the greatest.
那一般人称为他是 Mahapandit， 就是说是最伟大的学者。
He had defeated all others.
他呢，把所有曾经跟他面临的学者都驳倒了。
And actually, scholars ran in fear of him.
甚至呢，学子一听到他的名字，都很害怕，甚至躲开了。
They were afraid to debate with him.
任何的学者都很怕跟这个学者来所谓辩论比赛了。
Afraid of being humiliated.
因为辩论输了就很没面子，丢脸。
So the scholars put young Nimai Pandit up to debate with him.
所以这些学者们呢，就把这个尼麦潘迪呢，放到这个大学者的面前，让他一起对手。
They actually thought, well, young Nimai Pandit, he's not so old, he's not considered to be the greatest scholar. So, if he debates with Keshava Kashmiri and gets defeated, it's not such a big thing. Whereas if we do, it'll be a big thing.
那这些学者们想法是说，这尼麦呢，他年纪不大，然后呢，人们也没有认为他是什么多大的学者。那如果把他放在跟这 Keshava Kashmiri 面前一起对手的话，万一他输的话，也不会丢多大的脸，可是我们这些人已经够老了，万一输的话，这脸子挂不住了。
Really? That was the external reason.
这是表面上的原因。
But the Lord had another plan.
当然主有另外的计划。
He wanted to prove that this person, although so academically qualified, really was notqualified in the ultimate sense.
主要展示就是说，这个人在表面上看起来是很有学问，但实质上呢，一点都没有学问。
So as Keshava Kashmiri met with Nimai Pandit, a little he was in the beginning quite condescending, you know, being a little sarcastic, and then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu kind of flattered him and told him.Please, I want to hear some of your scholarship.
那这些学者们就把尼麦潘迪放到这 Keshava Kashmiri 面前啊，然后这两个学者呢，这个尼麦也是照世俗的礼仪，先跟他奉承一番啊。你这伟大的学者啊，有名的学者啊，我想要来听你讲述一下这些哲学。
So Keshava Kashmiri just immediately composed 100 verses.Glorifying Mother Ganga in very, very complex Sanskrit.
那 Keshava Kashmiri 呢，他马上就是用梵文编出100首诗，而且用很复杂的梵文的这一些诗节的结构来荣耀恒河。
Lord Chaitanya simply listened.
那主 Chaitanya 就只是坐着在那听。
And so after he finished, Keshava Kashmiri asked, so?
当这个 Keshava Kashmiri 念完了，这就说，那现在呢，怎么样啊？
Lord Chaitanya said, well, there's certainly no scholar greater than you.
那主 Chaitanya 跟他说，这很确定的，没有其他的学者比你还伟大。
But there are a couple errors in your Sanskrit.
那主 Chaitanya 对他说呢，可是呢，在你的这些诗节里面，在这个梵文的文法上有几个小错。
And this Keshava Kashmiri said, what do you mean?
Now Keshava Kashmiri 就说你什么意思啊
How could you even remember these verses? Any of these verses?
你什么意思啊我说了一百节诗你还怎么可能去记得呢
So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu、repeated three of the verses that he had composed.
所以 Chaitanya Mahaprabhu 就重复念出他一百节之中的三节诗里面的部分。
That was already very astounding to this Keshava Kashmiri.
他念出这三段的时候，已经让这 Keshava Kashmiri 惊奇了。
He said, "I don't know how you remembered these three verses."
他非常的惊愕的说呢，我不知道你怎么可能记得这些。
But anyway, where are the faults?
那不管怎么样，错在哪里？
And then, Nimai very clearly pointed out the flaws.
那尼玛就很清楚地跟他说哪里有错。
And Keshava Kashmiri was just—he was speechless.
这时候呢，Keshava Kashmiri, 无言以对。
And he couldn't say anything. But that evening, he prayed to the goddess of learning, Saraswati.
他实在说不出话来，所以当天晚上呢，他跟这个智慧女神来祈祷。
And she appeared and she told him that Lord, this Nimai Pandit or Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna.
所以这智慧女神、学问女神呢 ，Saraswati 就跟他说呢，这个 Nimai Pandit 呢就是主 Krishna.
And you should surrender to him.
所以你应该去向他臣服皈依。
Which is what Keshava Kashmiri did.
那接着呢 ，Keshava Kashmiri 就这么做了。
Of course, through this pastime, the Lord is trying to teach that it's not just mundane scholarship that is important, but what is really important is bhakti.
这个主，尼麦潘帝在这边要告诉大家，就是说，世俗的这些学位啊，是不重要，重要的是你的奉爱。
Now, the Lord goes into the Sankirtan phase.
接着另外一个阶段，主呢到了他去唱诵圣名这个阶段。
He visits Gaya.
他到这个 Gaya 这个地方去。
For the external reason of offering pinda, you know, offering. Yeah.
就是说去祭拜祖先啊，这个印度有个传统，他们会到 Gaya 这个地方去做。
A while in Gaya, he meets Shilishvara Puri.
他在 Gaya 的时候遇到了这 Mishra.
Ishvara Puri.
Yeah. You sometimes sound echo. Ishvara Puri.
Echo.
Yeah. From the speaker.
Okay. So the Lord takes initiation from him.
所以呢，至尊主就从 Ishvara Puri 那边去接受他的启迪。
And as soon as he does that, there's a vital transformation.
当他接受了启迪之后，有一个非常明显的转变。
And he starts to manifest ecstatic symptoms.
他接受启迪之后，他开始展示出他这种对神狂喜的这些征兆。
And around this time.He explains a very important verse.
在这段时间呢，他解释了很重要的诗节。
In the Brihadaranyaka Purana, he says, "Hari Nama, Hari Nama, Hari Nama, Eva Kevalam, Kalo Naste, Eva Naste, Eva Naste, Eva Kativa Nidha." Says in this age of Kali.
You explain. 这是在一部往事书里面讲的这一段诗节，然后他讲述出来。
So in this age of Kali, there's no other means, no other means, no other means for self-realization other than chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name of Lord Hari.
就是说，在这个卡利年代，再也没有别的方法，再也没有别的方法，再也没有别的方法，除了唱诵主的圣名，除了唱诵主的圣名，除了唱诵主的圣名。
So he says that it's not through Karma Yoga, it's not through Dhyana Yoga, it's not through Astanga Yoga.
所以这三次重复的意思就是说，这些过程的结果不是从活动瑜伽，也不是从知识瑜伽，也不是从体位瑜伽能得到的。
But he emphasizes three times that it's only through chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name of Lord Hari.
而且他重复的强调三次，就是唱诵主的圣名，唱诵主的圣名，唱诵主的圣名。
And then he explains the mood of chanting.
接着他又解释到在念诵的心态。
Tranadapi, Sunachena, go ahead. Taro, Eva, Sahishnuna, Amani, Namanani, Akirtaniya, Sadahari.
就是大家可以来念的这个范围也是我没有记得全部，但是这个意思说，一个人应该谦卑的心情唱诵主的圣名，唯有这样子才可以持续不断的唱诵吧。
One who thinks himself lower than the grass，
这个心态就是一个人要认为自己比路旁的小草还要卑微。
More tolerant than a tree，
要比一棵树还要宽容。
Does not expect honor，
一个人不去期望别人对他的尊崇。
But is prepared to give all respect to others.
而且随时准备向别人来致敬。
Such a person can very easily chant the holy name of the Lord constantly.
在这样心态的人就很容易持续不断的念诵主的圣名。
So he taught that one should wear this verse around one's neck, like a necklace.
那主呢告诉大家，就是说一个人应该把这节诗呢就像自己身上的项链一样挂在身上，随时记得。
Because it's essential.
因为这是非常必要的。
Unless one can do these things, one cannot chant the holy name of the Lord constantly.
一个人除非要到这个心境，否则他没有办法持续不断的念诵主的圣名。
So the Lord, he performs Sankirtan, particularly at the house of his devotee Srivas Thakur.
那主呢特别是在他的奉献者 Srinivas Thakur 的家里呢做这个唱诵圣名的活动。
And for many long hours each evening, he would gather his devotees.
那每天晚上呢他们在、啊、他在奉献者的家里很长时间的聚会唱诵。
Problem was, is that there was envy amongst those who were non-devotees.
问题出在那些非奉献者之中存在的嫉妒。
And one such person, who was particularly envious, was a person named Gopal Chapla.
哦，在那么多嫉妒的人之中，有一个特别的叫做 Gopal Chapla.
And what Gopal Chapla did, which was to try to show that Srivas Thakur was.Not a Vaishnava, but a worshipper of Lord of Goddess Durga.
那这个人这么嫉妒呢，要在这个 Srinivas 家里呢，就是故意说这个人他不是一个 Vaishnava， 但是他是在崇拜这个物质能量女神 Durga.
And so he placed the paraphernalia that's used in the worship of Goddess Durga on the doorstep of Srivas Thakur.
所以呢，这个人呢，心肠很坏，就把这崇拜 Durga 的这一些器具呢，放在这 Srinivas 家的这个台阶门前，这个门槛前面。
And Srivas Thakur in the morning saw all of his paraphernalia.
那 Srivas Thakur 早上开门的时候看到这些东西。
And he called neighbors to see him and said, "Just see how I am worshiping the goddess Durga."
那他这个人也很特别，他就告诉邻居，叫邻居过来看，你看啊，我这个人是在崇拜 Durga 女神啊。
But all the neighbors understood that actually he was a Vaishnava, and that someone had planted all of this here there to try to defame him.
那这些邻居们也很清楚呢 ，Srinivas Thakur 呢，他自己是一个 Vaishnava， 他们知道呢，是有人故意设计呢，来诬赖这个 Srinivas Thakur。
So what happened was is this Gopal Chapla got a very severe reaction for doing this.
那这么嫉妒的人 Gopal Chapla 他这么做他后来得到很大的报应。
Because he had offended both Srivas Thakur and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
因为他同时冒犯了就 Chaitanya Mahaprabhu 还有 Srinivas Thakur.
And he actually got leprosy.
后来这个人因为这种冒犯，他得了麻风病。
And he was, you know, actually dying. He was suffering with great, you know, great illness like this.
那他这个麻风病病得厉害，身上这些肉啊都要掉烂掉，甚至快死了，就是身上受的这些痛苦。
And because it is a contagious disease, oftentimes the lepers will go and live separately.
因为麻风病是会传染的，所以人们不敢碰到他，就和他隔离。
So、apparently, he was living somewhere by the bank of the Ganges. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes by.
他就一直被隔离，人家远离他，他就住。后来靠到旁恒河岸边去。那主 Chaitanya Mahaprabhu 到的时候，就有这样子的情况。
Gopal Chopra falls at his feet and begs for forgiveness.
这个时候 Gopal Chopra 已经受了那么大的苦，他在主 Chaitanya 面前顶礼，请他原谅。
But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will not give that forgiveness.
但是主 Chaitanya Mahaprabhu 不原谅他。
Instead, he curses him and says that I you know you will never be forgiven until you get the forgiveness of Shiva's Thakur.
那主不止不原谅他，甚至诅咒他。他说你永远没有办法得到原谅。除非你得到 Shrinivas Thakur 的原谅，你才有办法得到解脱。
So by and by that happens, and by and by, like Lord Chaitanya does forgive him eventually.
所以跟着这样的情况下去呢，这个人他去请求的原谅，接着主 Chaitanya 才接受他来原谅他。
Another pastime, Lord Chaitanya is performing Sankirtan with his devotees.
然后我们可以注意到主 Chaitanya 跟他的奉献者在进行这个唱诵圣名的活动。
And they, after many hours of doing Sankirtan, there's some fatigue.
这么多人这么热烈的唱诵呢，后来这人觉得身体疲惫。
So he asked his devotees, "What would you like for refreshment?"
然后他就问这些奉献者们，就说啊，你们累了吧？那你们要怎么样稍微舒缓一下，或是清新换气一下？
They say mangoes.
他们就说我们要芒果。
But there are no mango trees in the vicinity.
但是在那个季节里面没有芒果。
So Lord Chaitanya says, "Does anyone? Is there a seed of a mango?"
就 Chaitanya 就问说，谁知道哪里有这个芒果这个种芒果籽这个里面的种子
？Someone gives him a seed. He sows the seed in the ground.
然后呢？就有人拿这个芒果的这个种子给他呢，他就把它种在这个地上。
Immediately, a huge mango tree grows.
很神奇的，马上这整个芒果树长起来了。
Laden with many ripe mangoes.
而且呢，很多就很熟的这个熟的很美的这芒果长出来。
And they're huge.
而且这个芒果很大。
And there's no skin or very 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 thin skin.
这个芒果是这么好到这个皮是那么薄，几乎没有皮那样子。
But all of the devotees enjoy to their full satisfaction.
那这些奉献者就都在享受这样子这么完美的满足。
Lord Chaitanya comes in contact with a very renowned astrologer.
那 Chaitanya 又去遇到一个很有名的算命的人。
And when he starts to analyze Lord Chaitanya's chart, he sees that it's very strange.
这个大的算命家呢，看到去分析主 Chaitanya 的这个命相命盘呢，他觉得很奇怪。
He says this chart shows that you were the son of Nanda Maharaj.
就是说这个算出来就是跟主这个南达大君的儿子是一样的。
Previous birth.
所以说他前一世呢是主南达大君的孩子。
So Lord Chaitanya engages this person so that he will become purified.
所以呢，主 Chaitanya 就让这个算命家让他做服务，让他得到净化。
For he quickly realizes that Lord Chaitanya is non-different from Krishna. This is Krishna right before him.
那这个算命家呢，他做了服务之后，很快的了解到呢，这个主 Chaitanya 跟 Krishna 是同一个人。
Lord Chaitanya At one point, he gave an order, instruction that everyone should perform Sankirtan in their home. This should be performed in every home.
那有一次，主持人大家就给大家一个训示，就是说每一个人的家里都应该来进行这个圣名的唱诵。
But there was so much Sankirtan going on that many of the Muslims became upset.
那因为他这样的热烈的推崇呢，处处都在这个传送圣名，那当地的回教徒就开始觉得愤愤不平。
Thinking that this was some kind of a Hindu ritual.
啊，这些回教徒认为就是这是印度教的一种仪式吧。
So they went to complain to the person in charge, the Chan Kazi.
所以呢，他们这些回教徒就到当地的一个管理的人，就 Chan Kazi.
And hearing the plea of the Muslim population, the Chan Kazi sent some of his constables to the homes of some of these devotees and broke drums and told them that they must stop.
那Chan Kazi听到这些他们当地回教这个民众的请愿呢，所以呢，他就发出命令呢，就把这些士兵到这些奉献者的家里面去把他们的鼓打破啦。然后要禁止他们的唱诵。
So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu organized this huge civil disobedience movement.
那主 Chaitanya 就安排组织了一个很大的一个活动，一个运动。
And he gathered hundreds of thousands of devotees.
那他这样组织起来，就上百上千的奉献者聚集起来了。
Thousands of mridanga drums.
那有数千个 mridanga 鼓
，and they all went in procession to the house of the Chan Kazi。
这么上千人的这个行列呢，就一路唱到这 Chan Kazi 这个地方首长家去。
And he was so fearful that he at first he would not appear。
这个地方首长最开始很害怕，听到这个锣鼓升天了，他躲起来不敢出现。
But finally, Lord Chaitanya met with him。
那终于呢，主持太雅也见到这个首长
，and he actually debated with him，
甚至呢驳倒这个人的说法。
And he taught him that the chanting of Hare Krishna is not some type of ritual. It's not really Hindu as such.
那他也跟他说呢，就念诵 Hare Krishna 不是一种所谓仪式的活动，也不是所谓印度教的活动。
But it's an eternal, it's the Yuga Dharma, it's the process of self-realization for the age of Kali.
这唱